thank you for the invitation to speak here. Just to stand up straight. Okay. So I guess I want to just start with some motivation for what I'm going to talk about. So let's see. So the setting is generally Calabi-Yau manifolds. So quick definition. For me, a Calabi-Yau manifold is going to be a bunch of things. So X is a smooth manifold. Of dimension n, which I mean, I said the complex dimension, I mean, after you consider that omega is a symplectic form, j is a compatible complex structure. So when I say complex structure, I mean integrable. Together, this means that it's a Kahler structure. And capital omega is a J holomorphic, it's a J holomorphic N zero form. Such that up to a constant, and you take the wedge of capital omega and capital omega bar, you get little omega to the n. And here the constant is some meaningless thing. Basically just says that, in the right sense, the norm of capital omega is 1. So G is a Riemannian metric. So it's a Riemannian metric, and this condition says that actually the Ricci curvature of G is 0. It's a Calabi-Yau metric. So the Calabi-Yau manifold. Okay, maybe this constant is chosen, so when you look at the norm of omega with respect to G, it's just 1. Okay, so what does this have to do with Lagrangian submanifolds? Well, fact, just due to Harvey and Lawson, which is that, if gamma is a Lagrangian submanifold, then when I restrict capital omega to gamma, it's going to be equal to e to the I theta times the volume form of gamma. So gamma, this is volume form on gamma induced G, and theta is a map from gamma to S1, smooth. Think of S1 as being the interval 0, 2 pi, identifying 0 and 2 pi. So this allows us, so this is called the Lagrangian angle. Once we have this in hand, that's where I'm supposed to put it.
Wow,
okay, thank you. Okay, great. show them. Gamma is special Lagrangian. It's that. If should have given this a smooth. If theta gamma, the Lagrangian angle of gamma, is just a constant theta zero. There's another one too. All right, so from now on, we're going to assume theta zero is equal to zero because you can always replace omega, capital omega, with e to the minus I theta zero capital omega, which then means, so that loss of generality, you can make theta zero equals to zero. Okay, then there's some basic fact about special Lagrangians is that there's different ways of saying special Lagrangian. And basically, they're all equivalent by this first thing. Call this star. So, I'm just using star here, nothing more. So, theta gamma equals to zero is the same thing as the imaginary part of omega restricted to gamma equal to zero, which is the same thing as the real part of omega restricted to gamma is equal to the volume form of gamma, which is the same thing as, this is not trivial, right, so it is less trivial, but I mean, it's easy to prove, but it's like a deep idea, which is that gamma minimizes volume in its homology class. Okay, so special Lagrangians are interesting from many different perspectives. They satisfy some kind of interesting differential equation, or which is equivalent or implies the minimal volume minimizing minimal surface equation. So actually, it's going to be among everybody. Sorry?
Until that last thing, I might have thought X was not compact.
So if it's not compact, you can still make sense of this by taking like a compactly supported deformation or something like that. And so I'm going to want usually this when X is compact, but not always, because otherwise it's hard to make examples. All right, so that's special Lagrangians. So why? I mean, there's many reasons, but I think, so I mean, originally, maybe a lot of attention was drawn to special Lagrangians by the SYZ conjecture. Other people are going to talk about that. And I think maybe special Lagrangians are not really so important for the SYZ, well, I mean, for maybe the most interesting part of that so far. But for me, there's, well, so an object of the Foucault category of X, I'm not saying that it is, but meanwhile, is stable. You want to say something like this. It's not quite going to be true. But if it's isomorphic, and I mean, what is the? I mean, what's one reason why what to know what stability is? Well, I mean, for example, you might want to try to count special Lagrangian submanifolds or something like that. So, counting special Lagrangians representing some class in the nth homology of X should be something like a mirror to Donaldson-Thomas invariance on some other variety. That's an interesting thing to do. So stability is something one should be interested in.
Can you say briefly what stable means in the fact that thing?
No. I mean, there's many competing. What you might want to have is some sort of notion of a stability condition, like defined by Bridgeland, which would be constructed by declaring an object to be stable or semi-stable, maybe stable, if it has a special Lagrangian representative. But
I thought the reasoning was the reverse, that Bridgeland stability conditions come from looking at this picture.
Well, I mean, they're inspired by it, but just you can't actually, I mean, construct such a stability condition.
So it's not that this volume minimizing is supposed to say that the word stability can be.
I thought it did too. I thought this was like.
Well, I mean, that's where all the intuition for Bridgeland stabilities come from. But to actually prove that there exists, I mean, let me tell you all the examples of special Lagrangians that we know of. Okay, I mean, there's far, far fewer than you would need to construct a stability condition. I'm going to now list them on the board. Sorry?
The intuition comes from where? You just said.
I'm saying the intuition for, well, I mean, I guess originally it was in physics papers. I'm forgetting the name of the physicist at the Simon Center, and or formerly at the Simon Center. and then Bridgeland built on that. Sorry? Douglas, yes. Michael Douglas. I mean, he thought about special Lagrangians, looking at certain examples where you construct many of them, and in a non-compact case. And then he tried to mimic that in some kind of categorical language, and then Bridgeland found he could construct such things on categories of coherent sheaves. But the actual original setting of special Lagrangians, you can't really actually rigorously construct any stability conditions this way.
Can you, at least for most of the audience, which probably has no idea what stability means, can you at least say that this would mean that you could take any Lagrangian and an object of the Foucault category, you could express it in terms of special Lagrangians in some essentially unique way?
Okay. That's one way of thinking about it. There's a harder Narasimhan decomposition of objects in the Foucault category. In other words, in some sense, like stable objects should be, you know, in some sense generic or something like that. So it's like you can decompose a matrix into using the Jordan normal form. Yeah.
I never just sort of lived and say these things a few times, but I thought if you take this. Forget what they call it, the charge function, which is just integration of the volume from
yeah.
I thought maybe this volume minimizing immediately implied that, you know, the definition of stable has something about slope
yeah.
or subobjects. Do you know, is that true? Or?
Well, there's not really a notion of subobject in a triangulated category. So, I mean, that was kind of the beginning of Douglas's work on pi stability. And I mean, he was inspired by certain examples, explicit examples you can write down in a non-compact case of special Lagrangians. But in fact, as far as I know, you can't really actually define stability conditions in, say, on a compact Calabi-Yau manifold using special Lagrangians. So examples. Uh, Yeah, Mohammed. I mean, I was kind of trying to give my motivation in terms of things which, you know, but, you know, that's, I think the way I would interpret what Mohammed said is that special Lagrangians are somehow very plentiful. There are many of them. They're almost, like, they're generic in some sense, like a diagonalizable matrix is generic among all matrices.
But I thought you were also saying that, in fact, we can't prove that there are very many of them at all.
We can't prove that there are any more than the ones I'm going to write on the board now. So, example one is we take some x omega j big omega that admits a map, self map, which is first of all, anti-symplectic, and maybe also an involution, and in a, sort of like a souped-up version of anti-holomorphic. Okay, so then, why is this a useful thing? So the moment that you have this, you get, the combination of these two guys, this implies that this is anti-holomorphic. The moment is anti-holomorphic, the fixed points are of dimension n, real dimension n. Think about complex conjugation. And then again, so now that they're dimension n, this implies that when you restrict omega to the fixed points, you get zero. Which means that the fixed points are Lagrangian. And then, again using this, you get that when you restrict omega to the fixed points, you get, so it's going to be equal to its, sorry, should be a complex conjugation. So if it's equal to its complex conjugate, that means that its imaginary part is zero. So this means that fixed points are special Lagrangians. So anytime you have this kind of anti-symplectic, anti-holomorphic involution of a Calabi-Yau manifold, then so, summary, the fixed points of phi are special Lagrangian. So that gives you an example. Maybe sub-example, just for concreteness, take X to be n-dimensional Euclidean space, complex n-dimensional Euclidean space, then you can take omega, like the standard symplectic form, R to n, and this is the standard holomorphic n form. And then you can take phi to be complex conjugation. And it's pretty easy to see that those relations hold. And then the fixed points are Rn, which is a special Lagrangian. So that's sub-example A. Sub-example B, the compact case. This one you could just write down, even if you didn't know about the existence of anti-holomorphic, anti-symplectic involution. But this one is a little bit harder to get on by hand. So you take X to be the right, so we look at points in CPN such that P of Z equals to zero, N plus one. And P here is a homogeneous polynomial of degree N plus two. So then basically the Calabi-Yau theorem says that there exists omega and capital omega such that this X with an induced J from complex projective space, and these guys, it's Calabi-Yau. And in fact, moreover, this Calabi-Yau theorem, the uniqueness part of it, implies that phi can be taken to be just complex conjugation. That's going to preserve those metrics, that metric, sorry.
P's a real polynomial.
Yeah, sorry. P a homogeneous polynomial with real coefficients. Thank you, Vivek. All right, so then you get the real part, essentially, of some hypersurface and projective space is going to be a special Lagrangian submanifold. Okay, that's the end of that example. So that's example one. Example two. So there's just like two special parts of it. But basically, we're talking about a Calabi-Yau manifold with some kind of complex conjugation or generalization thereof on it. So then, fix phi is just the real part. Just the real part is special Lagrangian. Okay. So the second example is when X comes equipped with a hyper-Kahler structure. So we say that such a quintuple is hyper-Kahler if I j equals minus j I equals, sorry, I should have said what they are first. I, J, and K are complex structures. And I, J equals minus J, I equals K. So this is essentially the quaternion relations. And trip myself too. And also we want to say that omega I, which is going to be just G, so it's going to be a two form divided by G of I and omega J, G J, and omega K. So all three of these forms have to be symplectic forms. So that means they have to be closed, not degenerate. Well, they're obviously not degenerate, but they have to be closed. So in other words, G is a Kahler metric for each one of these three different complex structures. So they can't all be the same because they have to anti-commute. What was this? One was another. Yeah. first thing you think is such things don't exist. They do. So there's an example, of course, just like quaternion space, and or multiple covers, some direct sums of quaternions with themselves. But you can also do the simplest kind of compact example is you can take x as in example 1 b with n equals 2. This is the K3 surface. And then you can construct the hyper-Kahler structure using the Calabi-Yau theorem. All right, so then another little definition. We want to talk, 1 second. Okay. So if you have then you can define phi, capital phi is going to be the sum of say omega j plus omega k. It's going to be it's an I holomorphic to 0 form. Again, the type is given by I. All right, so gamma side of x is holomorphic Lagrangian. So say you have an I, so it's a complex submanifold with respect to I. It's called holomorphic Lagrangian. If phi restricted to gamma vanishes. All right. So then, sort of a pretty simple thing to check is that if you have a holomorphic Lagrangian, then before I write that, let's say, again, given X hyperkahler, you can have a capital omega, which is the following guy, omega I minus square root of minus 1 times omega k to the power n over 2. I should have said here that the dimension of x is still n, but it has to be equal to 2m. Otherwise, you can't possibly have such a thing. So it makes sense to divide by 2. Let's call this m, actually. And then we have to go like that. So if we take such a thing, then x omega j and capital omega is Calabi-Yau. Okay. So using the hyperkahler structure, we can construct a Calabi-Yau structure. It's something, it's less than, a priori it's less. So given hyperkahler implies Calabi-Yau. And so then the fact that I wanted to say is that if gamma is holomorphic Lagrangian, then it is special Lagrangian with respect to for this Calabi-Yau structure. Okay. And although this seems like a lot of extra complication, actually, it makes life a lot easier to find special Lagrangians because, okay, where do I go? This one to go up. I'm going to get stuck. Sorry? Oh, the hook is here. Thank you. Gamma is I. I can repeat it, but now is it out of reach? No, it's not out of reach. So gamma is I holomorphic Lagrangian. Does that help? Sorry? Maybe?
No, no, it helps me.
Okay. So, for example, you can take an elliptic and I holomorphic elliptic vibration. Say Lagrangian on this K3 surface, which I mentioned above. And I mean, these guys you basically get by doing algebraic geometry. And there are higher dimensional examples of this too. So once you're in the hyper-Kahler setting, you can construct a lot of special Lagrangians just by doing algebraic geometry, constructing, say, some holomorphic submanifolds, and then looking at them with respect to a different structure, with respect to J instead of I. That's what you're doing when you look at this Calabi-Yau structure. That's called hyper-Kahler rotation, and it gives you many, many special Lagrangians. Okay, so that's sort of history. And so the surprising thing is that if X is compact, these are all examples which I know of.
You can't even do a billion varieties? I mean, shouldn't there be?
Okay. Maybe that should.
I can't make them all fit inside one somehow. Maybe one can, but I'm just.
Sorry?
For some of them, you can make, like, the thing you did in one with.
So you're saying that maybe.
But you need, like, another direct window. I think there may be just.
Okay. Okay, let me see, up to deformation, will that help you?
Sure. Yes.
I was going to say that anyway, because it would be false. I mean, so there's a McLean proof that that if you have one special Lagrangian, you can find a lot of nearby special Lagrangians, sort of model on the sort of vector space H1 of L. So the question is, I mean, on the other hand, the SYZ conjecture would say that you should have a special Lagrangian vibration. In other words, many, many special Lagrangians, even when, say, the dimension of X is odd, it can't be hyper-Kahler. And if we're going to go to Mohammed's example, then we should really be able to decompose any object of the Foucault category in terms of special Lagrangians. So special Lagrangians would be kind of generic. And I mean, this is definitely not a generic condition. I mean, so.
Just to understand the second example.
Yeah.
It seems like you built a family of special Lagrangians over the real locus of the twister sphere. Is it really, if it has to say, is it a special case that, can I put it in the first example? Is it some complex conjugation? Or is it...
Well, I have to think about that more. I don't see it immediately. All right. I mean, there's something kind of different between them. I would guess not, but trying to rotate these boards. But not working. So where? What happened to all of the special Lagrangians? So, maybe the special Lagrangian condition is only an approximation to the real thing. And as usual in symplectic geometry, if something is only an approximation, it ought to be corrected by or modified something to do with holomorphic maps, in this case holomorphic disks. All right, so why does this seem like a reasonable thing to expect? So first of all, this is not a hard theorem to prove, but it gives a little bit of evidence for this hypothesis. So this is to appear. Well, basically, I'll set a little bit of notation. So let's say x, I, j, k, g, hyper-Kahler. It's above. So I'm going to write R is going to be the set of a, I, plus a, j, plus b, k, where a squared plus b squared is equal to 1. And so this is a complex structure for each a and b. Just use algebra. This is a circle of complex structures. So for almost all, or for all but countable number of complex structures in R, there are no theta holomorphic stable maps of any genus sigma, sorry. So let's say that gamma is holomorphic Lagrangian. There are no such guys. At all. Okay, so that means that in a sense, maybe the reason that that holomorphic Lagrangians are special and that you have many of them is because whatever it is that's modifying the special Lagrangian condition isn't there in the holomorphic Lagrangian case because there are no holomorphic maps. There are no holomorphic maps for almost any of these complex structures.
This gamma is holomorphic for which one?
I holomorphic. Okay, so essentially, so we don't know that for J, I mean, there's no holomorphic map, but we know that for, you know, a sequence of complex structures arbitrarily close to J, there are no holomorphic maps, which implies, sorry.
You can finish.
Oh, which kind of makes you think that whatever the contributions from J are, they should be in some kind of obstruction, you know, when you get rid of the obstruction, when you do the obstruction theory properly, they shouldn't contribute. What were you going to say, Nick?
Is the thing you just said an explanation of morally why the theorem is true?
I was...
You didn't say why it's true.
So why it's true? I mean, it's something to do with calibrations. It's not a hard argument, but I'm not saying the idea here. I was explaining why this tells you something about this idea.
I'm actually going to prove it in my talk on Thursday.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I mean, it's like a one-line proof. So, sorry? Three? Okay, so Ivan will prove this in his talk on Thursday. All right. On the other hand, it's not always so straightforward. So if we look at, say, so. That example, 1b again. So the hypersurface in projective space with say n equals 3 now, then we say nd is the number of appropriately counted with signs and so on and so forth, number of maps from the disk x gamma. So gamma is this is the special Lagrangian. Then nd, so oh right, of symplectic area d. So then nd grows exponentially in d. So there's a lot of holomorphic disks ending on these fixed points of involutions. So just seeing when there are, when there aren't holomorphic disks won't answer our question. But, so that was, this was for the idea, this is against the idea. This is.
When you say the idea is to modify by holomorphic disks, you mean to say you're thinking of looking at a Lagrangian which has some property which you can express in terms of disks.
Yes.
That's what you mean.
Yes. Right. That somehow in the presence of holomorphic disks.
You just take an ordinary Lagrangian, no holomorphic forms or anything, but then you require some condition in terms of disks.
Yes, yes. So I mean, the special Lagrangian condition should be modified by something to do with holomorphic disks. So in the case where there are no holomorphic disks, we have lots and lots of special Lagrangians. Now, sometimes we have special Lagrangians even when there are holomorphic disks. So this is kind of against the idea. Looks bad for idea. But actually, has to go a little bit further than just saying there are no holomorphic disks. I mean, eventually I want to write down an explicit equation which has to be satisfied, but so theorem Iruta Fukaya O Ota Ono says that, so we take x gamma as in example 1b, then it's going to be unobstructed. With trivial bounding chain. All right. So then it seems that maybe whatever our modification of the special Lagrangian equation is, it should have something to do with the bounding chain. So if there are no holomorphic disks, then everything is unobstructed and we don't have anything to do. If there are disks, then we can ask, is our Lagrangian unobstructed? And I'm going to say in a minute what that means, or at least very, very intuitively try to say what it means. And then if it is unobstructed, well, there's this thing you need to choose to say how it's unobstructed, which is the bounding chain. And if this bounding chain is trivial, then again, you should have no modification to the so this sort of this makes the idea more specific. Modify the special Lagrangian condition using a bounding chain. So I don't have much.
When you're saying unobstructed with trivial bounding chain, can I just think d squared is zero?
Means that d squared is zero without any corrections. Exactly, yeah. Exactly. That will do it. So that's what I'm about to say. Right. So bounding chains. Well, I would like to define, so this way I have gamma 0 and gamma 1 in some Calabi-Yau manifold, say, I want to define floor homology. Should be the cohomology of some complex. With respect to a certain differential. Okay. As usual, this is going to be basically a free, so say a lambda vector space generated gamma 0, gamma 1. So lambda here is Novikov ring. So this is a Novikov field. And mu 1 is the usual thing. So if you have, say, gamma 0, gamma 1, then this is P, this is Q, so then mu 1 of P should be equal to a sum of the number of say, holomorphic strips appropriate sense, let's say where U star omega integral is equal to E times T to E, that makes the sum converge, and we have to sum over Q here, and put here Q. All right, and the trouble is that in this generality, this doesn't square to zero, as Katrin was saying. Doesn't actually define a differential. You know, holomorphic disks can bubble off. So, in general, you would like to say that you know, you'd like to look at, say, P, Q, R, like this, and you want to look at the, this is going to be like a picture of sort of mu squared of p. It's going to be sort of a sum over all r's like this, and you want to say that this thing is basically a sum over its boundary of this moduli space, strips from p to r. Okay, but so if this was the only thing, then you'd be in good shape, because then the mu1 squared would be a boundary of something. It would be zero. But the other thing is, you can get pictures like this as well. So you can instead of splitting into two floor trajectories like that, you can split into one floor trajectory and a holomorphic disk. This is a holomorphic disk inside of this is a holomorphic with boundary on gamma zero. So at first order, you want to choose some chain on gamma zero. Looks like this. Suppose you have a bunch of holomorphic disks on gamma zero. So essentially, you want to pair them off or combine them in some way. You just want some chain inside of gamma zero. I'm not going to say with respect to which chain level theory, but you can choose many different ones. And once you have this, you can cancel out that boundary I drew over there by just counting by counting things which intersect V0 as well. I'm not going to have time to draw that, but all right, so in the end, what you get is that you can't define floor homology in general for a Lagrangian submanifold. But if you have a bounding chain, you can. And in fact, the definition of floor homology depends on a bounding chain. Upshot definition of HF gamma 0 gamma 1 depends on choice of bounding chain.
You see bounding. Oh, okay, chain, because there's a whole slew of these things.
So
it's not like just have one. For every disk, you hope to do it.
So you have, I mean, it's even more than that. You have, I mean, I'm only writing it to first order. You have to write something in terms of the A infinity structure associated to gamma 0 and gamma 1, and then you get this Mora-Cartan equation. And so this is sort of like the first order thing that you want to happen. And so of bounding chains, B0, B1, for gamma 0, gamma 1. And what we want to do is we want to say that special Lagrangian should be a condition on both a Lagrangian and a bounding chain. Modified so it's a condition for the pair 0, 0. So I have now erred on the side of too much motivation and too little being specific. But roughly speaking, the way to write some condition, or the beginning of the way to write some condition, which depends on a bounding chain, is this. So fix a base point say gamma star B star, and then sort of look at paths of Lagrangians starting at this gamma star B star. Say gamma T B T with gamma 0, B 0 equals gamma star, B star. But you want to look up to homotopy. So this is some kind of covering space. And well, given a path, I can define a number which doesn't depend on, it only depends on the homotopy class of the path. Well, I essentially want to look at the imaginary part of omega, so assume that an integral of imaginary part of omega where gamma star is equal to zero. So this is a basic cohomological obstruction that you have to satisfy, but then you want to sort of integrate the imaginary part of omega over the whole of the union of all the bounding chains in all of the gamma t. So you have this is gamma 0 and gamma 1. And as you move between gamma 0 and gamma 1, your bounding chains move along with you. There's a way to construct such things. It's not just...
What object is a bounding chain?
Sorry?
What kind of object is a bounding chain?
So for me, it's going to be a differential form. A differential form with...
What dimension?
It'll always be of degree 1.
Okay.
So I'm drawing here in the three-dimensional case. I'm thinking of it as being a Poincaré dual surface inside of my Lagrangian. And this will be sort of B0. And then so I mean, if I'm thinking about as things as differential forms, then I would of course have to. So when you work out the virtual dimension of such a thing, it actually turns out that, I mean, so for example, this is I'm sort of trying to draw the dimension n equals 3. So this is gamma 0 is a 3 manifold. Inside of it is b0, which is a two-dimensional surface. Then I can consider my family of bt. And as I move it along, I have a family of two-dimensional surfaces which trace out a three-dimensional submanifold of my... so all this is happening inside of x. And I can just try to integrate this imaginary omega over all those things. And so the theorem, but I mean, I haven't stated this in sufficient precision to make it a theorem, is that this integral only depends on the endpoints up to homotopy. Invariant of the homotopy class. So that means that you can, for example, say move one endpoint and look at the Euler-Lagrange equation which you get, and that gives you an explicit holomorphic disk-dependent equation involving B and capital omega and gamma. And you have to add some other terms, which I've talked about on other occasions. But in the end, you get a sensible, So let's call this, this is going to be some sort of M, some functional, depending on sort of the homotopy class of gamma T BT. And you can look at the Euler-Lagrange equation. Obtained by varying M plus some like classical terms, which I don't have time to write. And this gives you an explicit modification of a special Lagrangian equation, which recovers the special Lagrangian equation in both the examples which are known. I'm going to stop here, I guess.
Any questions? So can you say this again?
Can you write the formula?
For the classical terms?
Just the formula.
The formula? I mean, in how much detail do you want me to write the formula?
I understand, can you write something explicit for the Lagrange equation obtained for bearing M?
Okay. You want to think of V as a one form. So then it turns out that what you get is that essentially the differential of B is equal to, you have to say it's a bounding chain. So this is essentially going to be some kind of sum of all sorts of mu k operations, where I drop the classical part. That's what the plus means. So I just look at the parts coming from holomorphic disks. There's also this is part of that mu k, strictly speaking. And you also get something like the co-differential of B is equal to something like, I forget the exact formula, but it's something like maybe the sine of the Lagrangian angle plus all sorts of stuff. Okay, I mean, it's a complicated formula. I don't remember it offhand. Perhaps I should have prepared it, but I can show it to you after.
Maybe a more philosophical question. Usually the stability comes from this BTS bound, that central charge pulls energy. Are you quantum correcting the central charge or the energy? Or both?
I mean, physicists told me that I'm quantum correcting the entropy.
Okay, so the usual special Lagrangian condition is open.
The usual special Lagrangian condition?
Well, there's the MacLean theorem that tells you can deform.
It's
an open subset of the deformation space of a Lagrangian modulo Hamiltonian isotopy that you can realize.
The condition to have a special Lagrangian representative for a Hamiltonian isotopy class is open.
Good. So, but it's not known to be close.
Presumably it's not.
Do you think this is going to have a chance of having that property?
I'm not sure that I would be so... I mean, I think you'd have to throw in some singular guys as well. But I mean, this is sort of, even before you...
Can you go through a surgery
with this? I mean, I would expect that you could, but I mean... first of all, one would have to find an example of a smooth one of these guys, which is not trivial. I mean, a smooth solution to this, a non-trivial.
Well, we will talk about it.
Okay.
What do you mean it's open? What condition is open? In what sense?
So.
Well, I'm looking at a discussion here.
Jacob. So do you know any non-classical example of a solution to this equation?
No.
I mean,
yeah, so you wrote these two theorems on the right-hand boards, Condorcet, Solomon, Walter, and FOP, and one said that there's these very non-trivial discounts, and the other one said that you're unobstructed with trivial bounding coefficient. Doesn't unobstructed with trivial bounding coefficient mean that you have the discs is zero?
Okay, so let me draw you a picture. I just wanted you to ask that question. I would have liked to say it in the main body of the talk, but essentially what happens in the case of the involution, maybe this also sort of answers why I don't think the involution case is the same as the holomorphic Lagrangian case, but you have lots of disks on your Lagrangian submanifold, but they come in sort of in pairs like this. So if you think of the complex conjugation as sort of switching the red guy for the purple guy. And now if you want to do a bounding chain, so you have to take these two boundaries of a disk and connect them by some kind of surface, but they coincide. So your surface can just be the empty surface. So just the surface which goes between the boundary of the purple and the boundary of the red. So what that means, I guess the way Katrin was saying is that basically, you have all of these extra a priori boundary terms when you look at those one-dimensional moduli spaces, but they come with opposite signs.
Oh, so the Padre-Padre, et cetera, theorem was an unsigned count?
Well, it's a different signed count. I mean, there's many different ways of looking at these disks. And one of them gives them one set of signs, and the other one gives them another set of signs. So if you put one marked point on here, which is what you need to define the obstruction, then it comes with opposite signs. If you have no marked points on it, which is what we counted, then they come with the same signs.
Good. I'm going to suggest that we stop now for the moment, and any further questions can be asked over lunch or later this afternoon if Kate's still around. So let's thank him again.